Well, welcome back to the House of Mystery on KFNX Phoenix, 1100 AM, independent talk radio, best in true crime. We have a great guest again today. Joining us is Bob KOLKER, and he's a contributing editor for New York Magazine. He's also an author of Lost Girls. It's a New York Times bestseller, and was named one of the Publishers Weekly Top 10 Books of 2013. Thank you for being on the show with me.
It's my pleasure, Alan. Thanks so much.
So Bob, how did you, first of all, get into writing? Like, that seems to be a passion of yours. Where did it come from?
Well, I've been a journalist in New York City for over 20 years, but always specializing in longer magazine-length stories that focus on people who wouldn't necessarily ever have imagined that they'd become subjects for the media to cover. At New York Magazine, I had the, you know, ability to write long and nuanced articles that were carefully thought through, but I wasn't the one who they'd send to interview Kim Kardashian or the mayor. I would be the one who would talk to the person who had just been through an extraordinary experience, whether it was a crime or an amazing turn of events, but something that made them interesting but also vulnerable in a way. So I had to be sort of empathetic to their situation. And so when this amazing unsolved murder mystery landed in the New York City area in 2011, I became the person to not just look into the mystery itself, but also to get to know the families of many of the victims in the case. And Lost Girls, my book, ends up focusing as much on the women who died as it does on the mystery of who the killer might be.
Wow. Well, that must be pretty, how would I say, that's got to be a lot on the soul. So it's got to be a lot of turmoil you go through, like when you're involved in a crime like this and it's unsolved and it's continuing, and you meet family members and people, doesn't it sort of, it must really weigh on you?
It does. It's very difficult. Of course, it can't compare to the losses that were shouldered by the many family members who I interviewed and who I'm so grateful participated. And I have to say, they're in such a very, very peculiar and difficult situation, all of them. Just imagine if someone close to you had disappeared and for years the police didn't take their disappearance seriously because they were working as escorts at the time. All the victims in this case are escorts, the same way they are in many unsolved murder cases around the country. And then imagine that years later it turns out that your lost loved one is not just a murder victim but a victim of a serial killer, and suddenly becomes national news, and suddenly the national media is beating a path to your door, and they want you to be a spokesperson for your lost sister or daughter. And but what must be going through their head at the time, it was the first thing that I thought. I thought they must be angry. They must be thinking, where were you 3 years ago when she disappeared? Now the case is cold. And then at the same time, they must be excited because they think, well, the world is paying attention now. Maybe I'll get some closure. Maybe I'll find out who it is. But then, just as quickly, they start to feel panicked, thinking, well, there's no reason why this case might not go cold again. And, you know, who knows how long people will be paying attention. And so at the time that I interviewed these family members about, and friends also, about the many women who disappeared in Long Island over the years, they all were very eager to get their stories out and talk about what these women were really like, because the media had been sort of engaging in a long custom of victim blaming when it comes to sex workers, saying, well, they take their life into their own hands when they do this. But that to me wasn't fair. These women, you know, nobody wakes up in the morning thinking they're going to become a murder victim. These women were making very risky economic choices, but a lot of people make very risky economic choices every day, and we don't blame them when they die. You don't think that way about construction workers or police officers. But somehow when it comes to sex workers, we think, well, it doesn't matter who they are, they've just been killed. Yeah. And you see that in our culture everywhere, Alan. You see it on television shows. You turn on basic cable during the day, and there are repeats of every procedural, and the victims are almost always sex workers, and they are just plot devices. And I wanted to write a book where they were the plot, not the plot devices.
Right, right. It sounds like it's there's a whole concept here, the whole movement. Tell us a little bit about the case, so the people that are not aware of what's been going on, maybe give us a rundown of what happened.
Sure. And I'll just say before starting that one of the more interesting things about this case is that there are many, many cases like it around the country where, you know, you learn years later that there's been a serial killer operating, and the reason why they've been allowed to operate for so long is because they target women who they feel won't be missed, who the police won't take their disappearances seriously. And most often those women are escorts. In this case, the women were all in their 20s and petite and advertised on Craigslist and also Backpage, which is a competitor to Craigslist. But they weren't from New York. They all came from out of town to come in for days at a time in order to make money here and on Long Island. So I'll start at the beginning. There's a woman named Shannan Gilbert, who was 24 years old and working as an escort. And she and her driver one night drive out to a secluded community out on the south shore of Long Island called Oak Beach. Oak Beach is a very weird place. It's not fancy, but it is secluded, and the people there value their privacy. But there was one man there who hired her for the night. And in the middle of the call, she runs screaming from that man's house, knocking on doors, saying, they're trying to kill me. And then just as quickly, she disappears. And by the time a police officer comes, as the sun is rising, there's no evidence that she's ever been there. And everyone assumes that she just went on her way. And nobody takes her disappearance seriously. This is the spring of 2010.
Right.
Now, flash forward 7 months later, and it's just 3 miles away down the road from where Shannan Gilbert disappeared, they find four sets of human remains, all just a few hundred feet from one another, alongside the highway. A cadaver-sniffing dog out on a drill happens to find the first body, and then they find the three more within a day. And of course, given that all four bodies seem to be women who were, you know, about the same age as Shannan, the police assume that one of these women must be Shannan Gilbert, the woman who disappeared 7 months earlier. But they're wrong. All four women are not Shannan. They are women just like Shannan, who came from cities outside of New York to come in and work and then disappeared, and their disappearances weren't taken terribly seriously by the police. The first to disappear had been 3 years earlier in 2007, Maureen Brainard-Barnes coming in from Connecticut. And then in 2009, there was Melissa Barthelemy disappearing from Buffalo. And then in 2010, early 2010, just a few weeks before Shannan disappeared, it was Megan Waterman who disappeared. She came in from Scarborough, Maine, near Portland, Maine. And then finally, the last one to disappear just a few months before the bodies were found was Amber Costello. And she disappeared from Long Island, from Babylon, New York, where she had relocated just a few months earlier. Now, that could have been the end of it. They might have never identified the bodies, and they would have had very little evidence to go on, given that the bodies had been exposed to the elements for a long time. But they identified the bodies, and they kept searching for Shannan, and lo and behold, a few months later, they start to find more body parts. This is in the spring of 2011. More sets of human remains up and down the highway on the south shore of Long Island, down on Jones Beach, out in Manorville in the Pine Barrens, until finally you get something like 12, perhaps 13 different victims, all linked together by location. And almost all of them are women. There is one man and there is one child who is linked by DNA to the one of the women. So perhaps it was a mother and child who were killed at the same time. And so the theories start to spin out of control. People think, is it one serial killer? Is this just a place where many different murderers know that you can stash bodies, like, you know, the swamps of New Jersey years ago? What exactly could be going on here? And the police continue to have no leads. And that sort of can probably get you going on the mystery. And from that point forward, there's a tremendous number of theories that people float. And and a lot of activity back in the community of Oak Beach where Shannan disappeared. And, of course, I haven't even said what happened to Shannan. They still haven't found her at this point. But by the end of the book, you get a little bit more clarity about Shannan Gilbert's fate as well.
That's just, and so now, and you were mentioning earlier that you think this, you know, this is probably going on all over the country. And I know in doing, you know, interviews with people, I know there's like certain highways that have had, you know, like the highways of Highway of Tears in BC, and there's one in Texas and stuff. So do you think it's just people that are in a lower income, or people that are don't have much family, that are poor, minorities in some case, and as well as, sex workers?
Yes, absolutely. Anyone who's in a desperate situation or is making an economic choice to make enough money in one night, more than they would make for working for a month at Walmart or at Dunkin' Donuts, is also perhaps working off the grid or working independently on Craigslist. And they feel they're safe because they can somehow, you know, work from home or not have a pimp under, you know, who is mistreating them. But in fact, it isolates them even further sometimes. And if you aren't paying attention, you can end up putting yourself in a situation where someone who means you harm has actually targeted you based on your profile on the internet. They have gone shopping looking for the most vulnerable sort of victim online. This is a new type of killing that's out there, and it's detailed in Lost Girls, a way for a killer to find the exact victim they want by going on Craigslist and Backpage.
And so do you think that the police in general are, I don't want to say ignore, but don't give it the attention it deserves because of their sex workers, or in other cases, maybe poor or minorities or something? Do you think that's sort of where the angle is here?
Yeah, that is certainly one aspect of this book. And you see it time and time again as I tell the story of each of these five women. They disappear. The police don't care. The family members try to get their missing loved one's name on the National Database of Missing Persons. It takes months or even years. Occasionally, there's maybe one sympathetic police officer who does a little digging, but most of the time, even in the case where the alleged killer ended up making taunting phone calls to the younger sister of one of the victims, the police didn't take it seriously until it was too late to really track down those calls. It's just stunning to see how over and over again, an entire class of people can be overlooked and discounted. And that's the story I tried to tell in Lost Girls.
Now, do you think that these are all connected by the same serial killer, or do you think there's more than one at work here?
Almost certainly the four women who were found a few hundred feet apart, those first four women who were found in December 2010, they are linked together and most likely were killed by the same person. They all were shrouded in burlap, and they all were largely intact skeletons. And so one gets the sense that the killer perhaps even left them all there at the same time after storing some of them elsewhere. Now, when it comes to those other sets of remains, that's where the theories start to spin, start to bump up against one another. And you know, one popular police theory for a time was that the killer was refining his technique over time. You know, perhaps earlier on, he was dismembering the bodies and leaving different body parts in different places. And then over time had developed this idea of creating a sort of a trophy area where he could, you know, put intact bodies in burlap and be able to drive by and know that they were there. And then, you know, it's not unheard of for killers to refine their technique in this way. And then just as possible, he might have refined his technique by killing people ad hoc in the beginning, you know, anyone who was driving down the street and thumbing for a ride. But then over time, suddenly realizing that Craigslist and Backpage would allow him to find exactly the right person who he wanted to victimize. And that would explain why the last four victims, the most recent four, are so similar to one another. However, there's a whole other theory out there that says no, perhaps those four are linked, but the rest, there might be another killer. And believe it or not, there are cases out there, including the Jack the Ripper case, where two different killers are operating simultaneously and perhaps even competing with one another. There's a big theory in the Jack the Ripper case that there was that one reason why the Ripper murders ended was that there was another killer who was out there at the same time trying to compete. And so that is another theory. And then things get even more crazy as time goes on. There's a whole chapter in Lost Girls where the conspiracy theories start to fly over in Oak Beach and different people accuse one another of being involved. And one wonders whether the police or have turned a blind eye to people who, you know, they like. And then ever since the book came out, of course, the speculation hasn't ended.
Right, right. Probably grows from that. So now, excuse me. Now this has gone a long way. So you're saying that it's actually turning into documentaries as well. So it's going further than just the book.
Yes. The case is a lot of people. I'm sorry to interrupt, but a lot of people talk about an unsolved mystery as being perhaps, you know, in some way different from a lot of true crime books where there's at least a solution at the end of the mystery. This is an unusual book in that it is unsolved, but one thing about an unsolved mystery is that the case is alive and that you can participate by reading the book, but also by going online afterward and going on web sleuths or other forums and searching for your own clues. And that's what hundreds of people are doing right now. They're all trying to bring their own perspective to this case, and it's been fascinating to watch.
Wow. You know, for some reason I didn't think it was as massive as was there anything in particular that, or any type of person in particular, I mean, in the sex workers, were they looking for a certain MO, a certain age group or a certain hair color, or was there any of that involved in this?
Well, they all, those four women and Shannan, were all petite women in their 20s. The four women were white. Shannan was biracial with a light complexion. So you can come up with theories about that.
Yeah.
And then there were the only other named identified victim is a woman named Jessica Taylor, another petite white escort. So it's quite interesting that way.
And so what was, can you describe the crime itself? Like what was the eventual crime as they were murdered? How were they murdered?
Well, it appears that they were strangled. That seems to be what the medical examiner has said. The hyoid bones, the small bones in your neck that tend to indicate strangulation, those are broken in each case, according to reports. And so the theory is that that is how they were murdered. And then, you know, they weren't dismembered, those four. They were kept largely intact, but it's not clear whether they were completely skeletonized and defleshed or whether the elements took care of that. But it's clear, at least from reports, that the killer took care not to leave evidence with the body, and that when they were found, it was either the elements or the killer's, you know, great care in protecting himself that led to a real scarcity of evidence to go on in this case.
So they really have no evidence or no kind of design on what the person would look like or anything that could be doing these murders?
No, and one of the shocking things about this case is that there is no prevailing criminal profile of the killer either, and that's a scandal, really. It's been years, and the Long Island, the Suffolk County Police Department never really worked closely with the FBI to develop the profile. And there's a suggestion that the reason why the FBI was kept away was because there was corruption going on in the department, particularly the chief of detectives, James Burke, who's now incarcerated, was apparently trying to keep the FBI away from the Suffolk County Police Department because of his own criminal activities. And so that appears to be the reason why the FBI hasn't been able to really get in and be of much use in this case. But that appears to be changing.
Yeah.
As of this year, the FBI is involved, and who knows what will come of that.
Now, does this continue to go on to this date, or are there still sex workers and Craigslist people or Backpage people being killed as well to this date now?
Well, there are escorts who are killed all around the country. Their bodies are found, and it varies how they advertise, but online it seems to be the way that most people enter the field these days. It makes more financial sense in a way to work by yourself and not to share your proceeds with a pimp. And so, yes, I would say that while Craigslist has gotten rid of its adult services category under pressure from the various district attorneys around the country, that hasn't kept people from advertising on the sly on Craigslist. And Backpage continues to have its own adult services category, and people do advertise there. And those people, often work hard to take precautions and for their own safety, but just as often, many of them don't, and they're vulnerable. I mean, if you think about the best known names of serial killers out there, and I am not an expert in serial killers, but Joel Rifkin and the Green River Killer, just to name two, these people murdered escorts, and they've said since after getting caught, they said they murdered escorts because they were women who nobody would miss. And that's the tragedy here.
Yeah. Yeah. And where do you see this going now? Like now that you're bringing attention and the book's out and there's going to be some documentaries, do you see this going forward in a good direction? Do you think this is going to change things?
I hope so. I think that there's a lot of visibility for this case thanks to this book and thanks to the work of many other journalists out there, including television journalists. A&E has a documentary that's coming out in November called The Killing Season, and the first two episodes are about this case, and then they come back to it again toward the end of the season. It's an excellent documentary with a lot of detail about this case. I'm only on it for a short time, so I'm not promoting myself. I'm very much in awe of the work they did. And then I've heard that there's another documentary that'll be on an Investigation Discovery called People Magazine Investigates. And I think they're doing something on it as well. And of course, it's possible that your listeners who watch Investigation Discovery have seen repeats of 48 Hours. 48 Hours did an hour on this and focused on it and did a very nice job as well.
Yeah, I'm sure. Yeah, a lot of them would have. So what was the biggest surprise for you about the whole case?
Well, in the beginning, I had a lot of biases, implicit biases about sex workers. I thought that if they were ever killed this way, these would be women who you'd never be able to identify. But these women were identified, and they were not social outcasts because they worked online. They were able to work discreetly, and they had close relationships with their families, and they just broke away for a few days to work in many cases. And these are people who had close relationships with a lot of family members and right up until they disappeared. And that, to me, maybe because of TV and the movies or whatnot, like my thought was that if you were a murdered escort, that meant that you hadn't been in touch with anyone in your family in years and that you were addicted to drugs and living on the street and perhaps we're off the grid entirely, but that just wasn't the case here. That was the first big surprise. And then the other surprise was to spend time with, not just with their family members, but with other women who had worked alongside them as escorts. And I went into Times Square one night and hung out with a former escort who was best friends with Melissa Bartholomew when they both worked in Times Square. And she showed me, just by walking around and pointing out things that were going on, things that I never would have noticed before, how women were working and trying to pick up men right in front of my eyes in parts of town that I had walked through a million times before. So that kind of was an eye-opener as well.
Yeah, it's quite a shock that this goes on this day and age. And who do you have for influences when you write? Who has been an inspiration for you in your writing?
Well, I like the narrative crime stories that help lift a veil on a part of society you never otherwise see before. So for me, my personal favorites are books like Homicide by David Simon and Ed Burns, which looked at the Baltimore Police Department. And then, of course, The Corner, which David Simon also wrote, that looked at a part of Baltimore. And The Wire, you know, on television does something similar in a fiction aspect. And then there are other books like There Are No Children Here, by Alex Kotlowitz, about two boys growing up in the Cabrini-Green projects in Chicago. And that is not a straight crime narrative, but it has, you know, true crime as part of its, you know, part of the texture of the story. And then the big one, in my view, is a 11 or 12-year-old book called Random Family, which is by Adrienne Nicole LeBlanc, in which the author spent 10 years hanging out with welfare mothers in the Bronx and learning about their lives and then telling the story almost like a long epic soap opera, in which case they have boyfriends who are drug dealers and have children, and then the boyfriends go to jail, and then they come out of jail, and then the kids grow up. It's just a saga, and she writes it with such compassion and relatability that you just can't get your eyes off of what's going on there.
Yeah.
And I wanted to do a little something like that in Lost Girls, with women coming from these parts of America that the media just doesn't pay much attention to, places where the economy wasn't never really recovering since 2008, places where factories had gone away long ago and where the kids growing up there had a choice between Walmart or leaving town as in terms of employers. And they, you know, they saw, some of these women, that it made sense to become escorts because of the money they could make. But in writing Lost Girls, I also looked at In Cold Blood, obviously, because you know, there's a focus on a community here in Oak Beach, Long Island. And so I really appreciated what Truman Capote did in Cold Blood and writing about the community in that book. Just sort of giving you a sense that you were spending time there yourself and getting to know all of the people there. That was something I really tried to do.
Right.
And then I also was very much influenced by The Executioner's Song by Norman Mailer, because In that book is really two books. The part one is the crime, and part two is the aftermath and the trial and the media firestorm that happens afterwards. And that turned out to be how I eventually structured Lost Girls. The first half of the book is the lives of the women up until the time they disappear. And then the second half of the book is everything that unfolded after their bodies were discovered, including the media firestorm and the conspiracy theories and the many, many different, scandals and other things that happened.
So the conspiracy theories that come out, what do you think the cause for that is? Is that just people's fear, or their fear of the unknown, or is it, what do you think causes all that?
Well, in the particular case of Lost Girls, there are battles going on in Oak Beach between neighbors that happened, that transpired long before Shannan Gilbert disappeared there. There are people who have actively disliked each other for a long time, and so they're trying to pin her disappearance on one another, and that gets kind of complicated. But I think what you said has a lot of credence as well. People want clarity. They would like to link together things that don't necessarily get linked together. They would like a situation that has more logic than reality might have. We live in a chaotic world, a random world, a world where mysteries don't get solved overnight, where CSI teams don't come in and identify DNA in 15 seconds. And I think there is some small part of us that wants it, that wants the happy ending. And thinks perhaps you might be able to help. And you know, the fact is that certain web sleuths and armchair detectives working online have added a lot to cases over the years. They've been a particular help in many highly visible cases, trying to link together information that the police might not be considering, and so you can't take that away from them. But that's a little different from the grander conspiracy theories in this case, the idea that there's a, you know, community of killers in Oak Beach or whatnot. That just starts to get a little out
yeah,
there.
A little out there, a little bit. Yeah. I guess that's something we have to live with now, nowadays, with social media and everything just going. Where do you see yourself going now? Like, what's next for Bob?
Well, I continue to write long magazine stories, and I love learning new things and writing about all sorts of things, but I do come back to crime, whether it's violent crime or white-collar crime, even. In terms of the next book project, I really got something out of writing about the families in this book, and I want to write about another family who's dealing with something specific. In this case, it's not crime. I'm hoping to focus on one family's long and extraordinary story, and I guess we'll see if that happens. I really hope so.
Well, yeah, I mean, it should. Do you consider yourself a descriptive writer?
Yes, I consider myself a journalist, but really I'd like to be a narrative nonfiction writer. So very much in the mold of someone like, you know, Truman Capote.
Right.
And, you know, not that I compare to him at all, but you know, there are lots of folks these days, Laura Hillenbrand, who wrote Unbroken, and, you know, Eric Larson, who wrote The Devil in the White City. These are people who take the skills of reporting, but weave it into books that read like fiction, but are actually nonfiction. And that's something that I aspire to do.
Well, that's amazing. And so now for the book, what's the biggest thing that people are going to get out of buying Lost Girls?
Well, I think they're going to see a world that they may not have realized existed, but that was right in front of their faces. I think a lot of people reading the book may suddenly think twice when they go to let's say a rest stop on the highway, and, you know, go to the Dunkin' Donuts and look across the counter and see the person working there, and they may think that the person is leading an entirely different life now once they learn about these communities in the book. And then they'll drive along the highways and they'll look alongside and they'll say, you know, there are so many places where you know, people, missing people might actually be, but we just haven't put the resources or attention into tracking them down. I think at its best, this book lifts the veil on an aspect of our society that most of us don't think much about, but that in other parts of the country, you know, suddenly escort work has not become something people necessarily approve of, but it's become an option.
Yeah, it kind of opens the eyes to people, maybe, of things going on in everyday life that they're just not aware of. I think that's amazing. Now, do you think that the just one last part of it, I was thinking, do you think that the resources that we don't have, do you think it's that we don't want to spend the resources to find out things like this, or do you think that we're just don't have them? Like, I'm trying to draw the line between police solving crimes and not. Do they just don't care, or why spend the money on that kind of attitude, or, and not just them but society, or is it just a lot of people don't realize?
Well, there's a certain amount of misogyny and class-based antipathy toward escorts out there, both inside and outside the police department, but I don't think that that's every cop.
Right.
I do think that there's a certain amount of inertia and playing by the averages in anybody's field and any work. And you think, well, you know, you're missing your car keys. Do you look for them where the light is shining, or do you look for them where it's too dark to look? And so, you know, if you have 10 murder cases to work on, and, you know, two of them are women who are over 21 and were working as escorts, and who knows, might have, you know, by the law of averages, perhaps might have a drug problem, and who have, you know, phones that are off, you know, perhaps you're better off looking for those other eight possible murder victims where the leads are stronger, where the light's shining. And they just sort of shrug off the others and think, well, and this is where the antipathy comes in. They go, well, you know, they were taking risks out there, you know, their own fault. Yeah. And that, I think, is what happens in the worst case scenario. They really blame the victim.
Yeah, yeah. I really have to wonder if society will slowly get over that sort of concept of thinking, well, you did it to yourself. You know, that idea that you were doing this, so it's kind of your fault. Do you think in general we'll get over that?
Well, I think that what happens is the debate over prostitution appropriateness in our society tends to upstage that conversation. And so you have a whole bunch of people saying that anyone who works as a sex worker is victimizing themselves and is subjugating themselves to, you know, to a difficult situation, and you frown upon it and you say it should be illegal. And then you have a whole bunch of other people who say, well, we should legalize it because it would lead to less harm and it would destigmatize it and provide perhaps even a safe income stream for people who otherwise aren't working. And this debate happens within feminism. There are feminists who hate prostitution and there are feminists who champion it as a way of enfranchising disenfranchised populations. So it gets awfully complicated. What I feel personally, I don't get into this in Lost Girls because I didn't want it to be a preachy book.
Right.
But what I think is that regardless of whether you want to legalize prostitution or not, the real crime happens in pretending that it just doesn't exist, that it isn't happening, because that's the sort of thing that the serial killers of the world are counting on. And I say that, you know, that sounds a little coy to be like, you don't think, well, you know, how many serial killers are there? But the fact is there are a lot of missing women around the country, not just in places like Long Island, but along trucking routes, you know, where women work at truck stops and suddenly get picked up and never disappear. It happens, you know, there's the Grim Sleeper case in Los Angeles. There's a case in Detroit with many, many escorts. There's Robert Pinkton in Canada who had 30 victims. It just goes on and on and on. And perhaps destigmatizing prostitution becomes job one before you even wonder if it's illegal or not.
Mm. Yeah, very good point. Well, Robert, so how do people get a hold of you if they have a comment or...
I get lots of emails from folks who've read the book with different theories, and I love hearing from them. My email is bob@robertkolker.com.
Okay.
That's KOLKER, robertkolker.com. Yeah.
And we'll have you listed on our site as well and your book as well.
Oh, great.
The link, we'll have that all up probably within a day. And
if you guys go on the website of the book, there is an interactive map of the case that can help you understand this a little better, and that's lostgirlsbook.com.
Excellent. I'll make sure that's up as well. Well, I really appreciate you taking the time. I know you're busy with journalism and writing for magazines and books and doing all this stuff. So, again, our guest has been Bob KOLKER, and the book we're talking about has been Lost Girls. And thank you very much for being on the show.
My pleasure. Thank you.
The mission has been completed.
The end.
By George, he's got it. It is the end.
I'll see you.
This has been a production of the Z-Talk Radio Network.
If you're lying to me, I'll be back.